Welcome, everyone, and thank you for the opportunity to meet with all of you today. As part of CNA's Government Relations Program, we're happy to be able to present this virtual interview with James Maloney, Member of Parliament for Etobicoke-Lakeshore and Chair of the House of Commons Standing Committee on Natural Resources. We're going to hear his views on the role of nuclear and SMRs in meeting key government goals. We appreciate the opportunity to meet virtually with you today, James, and appreciate the support you've given to the nuclear sector and SMRs. In preparation for our conversation today, I was reviewing your June 2017 report from the Standing Committee on Natural Resources, which you chaired, of course, and the subsequent federal government recommendations based on that report. And for our viewers, I'd just like to remind everyone that Mr. Maloney's chairmanship of that standing committee and that report ended up getting support from all parties recommending that we continue to develop nuclear and small modular reactors in Canada. One of the recommendations specifically around SMRs was picked up by the federal government and led to the SMR action plan. And of course, a great deal has happened since then. I know we'll be touching on that today. But we look forward to hearing your views on where the government and the Liberal caucus discussions are trending and the work being planned by the Natural Resources Committee this time around. So let me properly introduce MP James Maloney. James's journey to public office began in 2014 when Toronto City Council appointed him interim councillor of Ward 5 until the municipal elections could be held in October of 2014. Elected to Parliament in 2015, James continues to serve his community in Ottawa. A civil trial lawyer by training. Well, it's a good thing I'm asking the questions today, eh, James? James is originally from Thunder Bay, but has lived and worked in Etobicoke for 40 years. He earned a Bachelor of Arts degree from Bishop's University and law degrees from the University of Windsor and the University of Wales in Cardiff, UK. James has a varied volunteer background. He's the former president of the Toronto Lawyers Club, serves as the board of directors of the local Franklin Horner Community Center and the Catholic Children's Aid Society of Toronto. He's the proud recipient of the Queen's Diamond Jubilee Medal. James is currently the chair of the House of Commons Natural Resources Committee and sits on the Justice Committee. He's also the chair of the Toronto Caucus. Wow, it's great to have you here, James. Thank you for joining us.
Well, thanks, John. Listen, I'm thrilled to be here. It's an important topic, and I appreciate the opportunity to be here. You talked about some of the things we've done at the committee and whatnot, and I'm looking forward to having a discussion today and sort of getting into it a bit more. So, very grateful.
Well, speaking about grateful, when that recommendation came out for the development of the roadmap, the industry has really jumped into high gear. So much has been accomplished since then, building off of this incredible nuclear ecosystem we have in place right now because of the $26 billion refurbishment. I think that's Canada's largest refurbishment going on in Ontario. If our reactors here, we have such a healthy and innovative ecosystem, and we're really turning that towards the small modular reactors. And really, James, I hope that in the coming years, you're gonna look back at your leadership on this front and see that SMRs are really contributing to our GHG goals and to job creation and innovation. So,
you're being very kind. I'm hoping to look back on it and look at a government that pushed the agenda, but I don't know that. I think you're giving me personally far more credit than I deserve, John, but thank you.
Well, listen, time is flying. We met in September of this year, and it seems like a lot has happened even since then, not only in the nuclear sector, but look, we've had elections in BC, Saskatchewan, New Brunswick. Yeah. Second wave of COVID-19 has hit, and you just mentioned as we were opening here that another lockdown. Federal government is looking to release its economic updates and seems to be heading towards a March budget in 2021, and there's a new president-elect in the United States, so a lot going on.
It's things are changing by the day. It's I can't even keep track of the months anymore. I mean, March seemed just a few weeks ago, and now you're right. So much has happened. Because of our environment right now, things sort of the seasons the usual benchmarks don't sort of jump out at you. So everything, the time gets a little bit muddied up, and it goes very, very quickly with so much going on. But and some of it's positive, but we're getting through the bad stuff too.
You're so right. So listen, I have a short number of questions for you here today, and I'll just launch right into them, and
sure,
you can take them wherever you like. Why don't we start with this? What role do you see for nuclear and SMRs in meeting the government's agenda?
Well, I think it has a big role personally. I mean, John, you know this, but other people who are watching might not know this. Before I was elected, I didn't come from a place where I was working in the nuclear field or in any way, really. But when I was elected in 2015, I asked to be on the Natural Resource Committee, and I was fortunate enough to be chosen to serve as chair, which I have again in this parliament. So, and one of the reasons I did that is because I saw how important it is, and I appreciate how significant our natural resources are, and in driving our economy, and the nuclear sector is a big, big, big part of that. So, you know, you referred earlier to our report in 2017 when the committees choose their own destiny, so to speak, and we decided to examine a number of things, and one of them was the nuclear sector. And you also mentioned this too. Look, the parties, you know, everybody looks at Parliament and thinks all the different parties don't get along on all the different issues, but there's a lot of areas where there's a lot of commonly shared views, and I think this is one of those examples. So when we studied the nuclear sector, it was with a view to how we can continue promoting it and what can be done to encourage it as part of our energy piece going forward. And look, I mean, all governments are interested in moving forward and reducing carbon and having clean energy. And nuclear is a big part of that, has to be a big part of that, because it's one of the, it's no carbon emissions. I mean, and one thing that always surprised, and I love doing this, I talk to people in Ontario in particular, when you bring up nuclear, who don't know anything about it, I said, do you know how much your electricity is generated by nuclear power? And the answer is always, you know, so far off what the actual number is. I mean, you know, it's around 60% in Ontario, and it's significant in other places like New Brunswick as well. So when people hear that, it's sort of, you know, forces them to pause for a second and think about what that means. And what it means is it should be relied upon even more so than it already is moving forward. And the SMRs are a big part of that. SMR technology is potentially, you know, it can change things in so many ways. And again, I learned this after I got elected. I started meeting with groups, and I remember meeting with a couple of different organizations who were involved in SMR development. And it's fascinating for one thing, but when you think about the impact it could have on so many different aspects of our economy, I mean, you know, the mining sector is an obvious one. Mm-hmm. All of these remote places that now rely on diesel fuel to generate their power where they are, this is game changing. Even in smaller communities, even in larger communities, I mean, it's clean, it's efficient, it produces much less waste. But you know, having said that, it's still very much in the development stages. So, John, as you know, and we've got a long way to go, and that's another reason why we should be encouraging it, is because Canada's always been a leader in the nuclear field, and this is an area where Canada can really be out in the forefront of this technology. So we need to, in my opinion, we need to do everything we can to try and encourage that. So it should play a big role.
I think you just stole all of my lines for this discussion. you know, I will say things are moving very quickly. A couple of reflections on what you just spoke about. I mean, you know, since 2017, and that report and the development of the action plan, you know, people are speaking a lot more about nuclear, right? And I think that's the case in the media. The SMRs are really a new way to approach nuclear, and it's generating conversations. But we also observe it as an industry with your colleagues and others in government, right? We've got a fierce champion of nuclear and small modular reactors with Minister Seamus O'Regan.
Oh yeah, and, very much so.
Yeah, very much so, and very positive signs from your other colleagues as well, including Minister Wilkinson now and Ministers McKenna and others. So very much appreciated. And the other thing is, you speak about it being a long road to this. I agree. We're going to have to continue to be focused on it. But that announcement that came out from Ontario Power Generation just last week about targeting the first small modular reactor in Ontario being connected in 2028 is very positive to put that stake in the ground. And we think that the very small modular reactors, the ones that might be used in these northern communities, as you suggest, will probably be available before that by 2026, we believe. So we're not so far away, and we'll continue to focus. But may I ask you, James, what sort of work are you undertaking with the committee this time around? Is there?
Yeah, well, so, the election was 12 months ago, but it's, as we referred to earlier, it's been such a strange year. I mean, Parliament, this is how Parliament looks right now, John. I mean, I'll be sitting in the House of Commons after we get off of this call. In Parliament on Zoom. So, Parliament was recalled in late November last year after the election. We sat until Christmas, and then we went and sat in February, late January and February last year, and then March came along and everything, as everybody knows, everything shut down for a prolonged. So the effect of that was that everything got sort of pushed aside to deal with the crisis at hand. And unfortunately, that meant some of the work of our committee as well. So we're a year out from the election, but we're not a sort of a year into the work of the committee because of that. But what we did is we, as a group, we sat down, as we always do, with members from all parties and decided what the direction is we're going to take this session. And right now we're doing a study on the forestry sector. But it's not confirmed yet, but very, very likely what's going to happen next is we're going to be doing a study on critical minerals. And I suspect that will probably get going. Again, it depends on timing and where things are at, but probably sometime, around February. And, uranium will be part of that discussion.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, that's right. Uranium will be part of that. It's I'm thinking a long way back to sort of high school or middle school, and thinking about one of the great teachers I had, who was a geography teacher, who actually managed to make things stick and talked a lot about Canadian makeup and history about that time as well. And remember the lessons about Canada's economy being such a natural resources driven economy, which I didn't really appreciate at the time until getting into the energy field much later. But you talk about the forestry work that you're going to be doing, or the critical minerals, and when we look at the role that SMRs can play in helping to decarbonize some of these other sectors, whether it's mining or oil and gas extraction, creation of steel or cement, fertilizer, potash. It's really quite remarkable. So I haven't looked at all. Yeah.
No, it's vital. I mean, if you look at, you're right. I mean, as you mentioned earlier, I was born in Thunder Bay, and I think so. When I asked to be on the Natural Resource Committee, I think it was because of sort of a genetic predisposition, perhaps, because growing up in Thunder Bay, you have some, you learn an appreciation for the resource sector in this country, but it plays a massive role. Like even here in Toronto, I mean, even if you're born and raised in Toronto, you appreciate the value of the resource sector. I remember when we were doing a mining study early on, this was in 2016 probably, and we had some guys in, and one of them posed the question to the committee. He said, do you know where most of the mining in Canada is done? Or mining business done in Canada? And, everybody's expecting to say Northern Ontario or, the far north or something. He said, Bay Street. you know, so it's just the resource sector is a big part of the economy in downtown Toronto too. So don't forget that. And he's right too. And I've never forgot that statement.
Yeah. Well, there's so much sizzle around, you know, technology and things like that. And we have to continue to grow that, but not forget that our natural resources are really the heart of our economy.
Yeah, absolutely. So,
Let me ask you this. You mentioned at the outset that there was this multi-partisan support for small modular reactors in the Standing Committee's report. Do you think that's going to continue now as we, you know, we're expecting the federal your government to come out with a, you know, SMR action plan? We're hopeful that we'll continue to see more investments. We saw some investments in $20 million investment in terrestrial power. We're hoping to see continued investment by this government as we go through the next two economic events. Where do you think the other parties are going to land on nuclear, or where are they trending right now?
I don't think it's changed. I think we're still going to be united in the direction we're taking. Politics being politics, John. We come out with a plan or a roadmap, whatever it is, you know, don't misunderstand that shared desire to mean that all the other parties are going to come out and say, you got every aspect of this absolutely right. You know, there's going to be comments and criticisms, I'm sure. But look, I don't think that the views that everybody holds that it's an important thing to move forward on are shared. I mean, it's a shared goal, that's for sure. I mean, look, and you know this, I mean, New Brunswick, Ontario, Alberta now, Saskatchewan have signed on with this memorandum of understanding for SMRs. All four of those provinces are run by different political parties than I belong to is the government in Ottawa. So, I mean, on an issue that's this important, I think politics are put aside and people realize the significant value that it brings to the environment and to the economy and what a driver it can be. So I think that you'll see all party support on this.
Do you feel it's important that we, as an industry, sort of focus on the regional benefits here, and let me just expand on this a bit, James, because while I have you, I wouldn't mind getting some advice. You know, you mentioned Alberta, Saskatchewan, Ontario, New Brunswick. The premiers have signed an MOU there, where it's showing that that nuclear is becoming a truly pan-Canadian tool that folks can use, and each of those provinces has different reasons that it wants to use small modular reactors. You know, Alberta for its extraction industry, Saskatchewan to phase out coal, New Brunswick creating a new innovative hub, and et cetera. You know, maybe the folks in BC or Quebec, where you have 100%, almost 100% hydro, aren't so convinced that SMRs are great for them. I sort of feel sometimes like we should be delivering the message that, you know, certain regions are going to need it more so than others, and maybe we'll see first mover provinces and other ones that come on later. I'm just wondering what you think about those dynamics we have with this huge country with varied interests like this.
Well, I mean, that's you've identified a major issue that we deal with in this country is we're huge, right? And I mean, what goes on in BC is physically and in other ways far away from Quebec and New Brunswick and Newfoundland. So, you know, the provinces that are more reliant on hydroelectricity might be slower to come around on the industry. I don't think that is a reflection of their view on the nuclear sector. I just think it's driven more by availability and need in their own province and their own situation. I think what you'll see, and it's inevitable in my opinion, is once this technology develops and is rolled out and you see it implemented in Ontario and Alberta and Saskatchewan, New Brunswick, other places, I think other provinces will start adopting the technology. It just seems like a natural transition because it is, you know, seeing is believing. I mean, It's maybe not something that's driven out of necessity in some of these other provinces we're talking about, but when they see how efficient and effective it is in a few years' time, you know, it's hard to believe that they won't start looking at it and trying to adopt it as well, right? I mean, and especially if it's Canadian-driven technology. I mean, you mentioned terrestrial. You know, there's a number of Canadian companies. That's one of them who's developed working on this technology, and and we can and should be a world leader in this. Canada's been a leader in the world on nuclear technology since the 1950s. Here's the new generation of technology, and we've got a real chance here to dominate.
You're so right. We have such a vast experience. We're a tier one nuclear nation. We're globally respected for the work that we do here. We got an amazing innovation going on. You're right. This is one area we can help ourselves and help others too. Yeah. So I've got one final question for you here. It has to do with Canada-US relations.
You saved the easy one for last, did you?
Yeah, save the easy one for last, yeah. Do you have a sense of what the role of nuclear is going to be in Canada-US relations?
That's a harder question to answer, John, right now. I mean, things are, you know, that things are a little bit uncertain right now in terms of how things are going to play out south of the border. Things are a little bit uncertain what the future is going to look like. I mean, President-elect Biden is a friend to Canada. I don't see any reason why there won't be a positive relationship in this field too, but that one's a little bit harder to sort of give you a definitive answer on, but it's optimistic.
It is early days for us in the sense that, you know, Canada went down the road of can-do and America with the conventional reactors went down a different road, but with small modular reactors, there's a lot of cooperative work going on between the regulators and between industry. Yeah. Our association has a memorandum of understanding with our equivalent in the States, and the CNSC, the regulator here, regulator here has one with the regulator in the States. And maybe if and when President-elect Biden
becomes president,
we'll see where things are going politically. Yeah.
Yeah, that's right.
Well, listen. It's been a real pleasure to be able to speak with you today. I know you've got a very busy schedule and agenda, but
the pleasure is mine. Honestly, let me just say thank you, because I mean, what you guys are doing is great. I mean, you have to spread the word, and you guys, you know, this is part of that effort, and I appreciate that, because I talk about the nuclear sector all of the time. Look, I'm here in Etobicoke. You talk about being in Toronto. I've got, you know, Kinetrix right around the corner from me. Mm-hmm. I mean, these guys are doing things right now that are potentially groundbreaking with Bruce Power. So, and people aren't fully aware of that. So we have to share this message and remind people how important it is, and remind people that all of the positive developments that come from the nuclear industry. And when people hear it, they get on board. We have to shake off the negative stigma that's around the nuclear sector, and I think that's a thing of the past almost, to be honest with you. People realize how important it is and how much value added it is to the economy. So listen, I really am grateful to be here, and I'm always happy to, along with my other members at our committee, to work on this and see how we can move the ball down the field. And we're always happy to hear from you guys too. So please let
us
know.
Thank you very much. Okay. Thanks. That's James Maloney. Have a great day.
All right. You too. All right. Bye-bye.